Section 17 of John Brown by W.E.B. Dubois. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 11. The Blow. Part 2. The attack came at noon from the Jefferson Guards, who started across the Potomac Bridge from Maryland. This is Anderson's story. It was about 12 o'clock in the day when we were first attacked by the troops. Prior to that, Captain Brown, in anticipation of further trouble, had girded to his side the famous sword taken from Colonel Lewis Washington the night before, and with that memorable weapon he commanded his men against General Washington's own state. When the captain received the news that the troops had entered the bridge from the Maryland side, he, with some of his men, went into the street and sent a message to the arsenal for us to come forth also. We hastened to the street as he ordered, when he said, "The troops are on the bridge coming into town. We will give them a warm reception." He then walked around amongst us, giving us words of encouragement, in this wise: "Men, be cool. Don't waste your powder and shot. Take aim and make every shot count. The troops will look for us to retreat on their first appearance. Be careful to shoot first." Our men were well supplied with firearms, but Captain Brown had no rifle at that time. His only weapon was the sword before mentioned. The troops soon came out of the bridge and up the street facing us, we occupying an irregular position. When they got within 60 or 70 yards, Captain Brown said, "Let's go upon them," which we did, when several of them fell. Again and again the dose was repeated. There was now consternation among the troops. From marching in solid martial columns, they became scattered. Some hastened to seize upon and bear up the wounded and dying. Several lay dead upon the ground. They seemed not to realize at first that we would fire upon them, but evidently expected that we would be driven out by them without firing. Captain Brown seemed fully to understand the matter, and hence, very properly and in our defense, undertook to forestall their movements. The consequence of their unexpected reception was, after leaving several of their dead on the field, they beat a confused retreat into the bridge, and there stayed under cover until reinforcements came to the ferry. On the retreat of the troops, we were ordered back to our former posts. At this time, the negro Newby was killed, and his assailant shot in turn by Green. Two slaves also died fighting. Now, there was comparative quiet for a time, except that the citizens seemed to be wild with terror. Men, women, and children forsook the place in great haste, climbing up hillsides and scaling the mountains. The latter seemed to be alive with white fugitives, fleeing from their doomed city. During this time, William Thompson, who was returning from his errand to the Kennedy farm, was surrounded on the bridge by railroad men, who next came up, and taken a prisoner to the wager house. It was now 1 o'clock in the day, and while things were going against Brown, his cause was not desperate. His Maryland men might yet attack the disorganized Jefferson Guards in the rear, and the arsenal was full of hostages. But militia and citizens kept pouring into the town, and by 3 o'clock could be seen coming from every direction. Coggy sent word to Brown urging retreat, but Brown faced a difficult dilemma. Should he go to Loudoun Heights and lose half his men and all his munitions, or should he retreat to Maryland? This latter path lay open, he was sure, by means of his hostages. Meantime, the Maryland party might appear at any moment. Indeed, the Jefferson Guards had once been mistaken for them. On this account, the message was sent back to Coggy to hold out for a few minutes when we would all evacuate the place. Still, the Maryland party lingered with the stubborn Tid somewhere up the road, and Cook idly kicking his heels at the schoolhouse. The messenger, Jerry Anderson, was fired on and mortally wounded before he reached Coggy, and the latter's party was attacked by a large force and driven into the river. "The river at that point runs rippling over a rocky bed," writes a Virginian, "and at ordinary stages of the water is easily forded. The raiders, finding their retreat to the opposite shore, intercepted by Medler's men, made for a large flat rock near the middle of the stream. Before reaching it, however, Coggy fell and died in the water, apparently without a struggle. Four others reached the rock, where, for a while, they made an ineffectual stand, returning the fire of the citizens. But it was not long before two of them were killed outright, and another prostrated by a mortal wound, leaving Copeland, a mulatto, standing alone, unharmed, upon their rock of refuge. Thereupon a Harper's Ferry man, James H. Holt, dashed into the river, gun in hand, to capture Copeland, who, as he approached him, made a show of fight by pointing his gun at Holt, who halted and leveled his. But to the surprise of the lookers-on, neither of their weapons were discharged, both having been rendered temporarily useless, as I afterward learned, from being wet. Holt, however, as he again advanced, continued to snap his gun, while Copeland did the same. Copeland was taken alive, and Lehman, with a second message from Coggy to Brown, was killed. Matters were now getting desperate, but the armory was full of prisoners, and therein lay John Brown's final hope. Easily, as a last resort, he could use these citizens as a screen, and so escape to the mountains. In attempting this, however, some of the prisoners were bound to be killed, and Brown hesitated at sacrificing innocent blood to save himself. He thought that the same end might be accomplished by negotiation. His first move, therefore, was to withdraw all his force and the important prisoners to a small brick building near the armory gate, called the Engine House. Captain Dangerfield, one of the prisoners, says, "He entered the engine house, carrying his prisoners along, or rather part of them, for he made selections. After getting into the engine house, he made this speech: 'Gentlemen, perhaps you wonder why I have selected you from the others. It is because I believe you to be the most influential, and I have only to say now that you will have to share precisely the same fate that your friends extend to my men.' He began at once to bar the doors and windows and to cut portholes through the brick wall. This evident weakening of the raiders let pandemonium loose. The citizens realized how small a force Brown had and were filled with fury at his presumption. His men began to fight desperately for their lives. About the time when Brown immured himself, a narrator reports, a company of Berkeley County militia arrived from Martinsburg, who, with some citizens of Harper's Ferry and the surrounding country, made a rush on the armory and released the great mass of the prisoners outside of the engine house, not, however, without suffering some loss from a galling fire kept up by the enemy from the fort. This released the arms, and one of the Virginia watchmen says, "The people who came pouring into town broke into liquor saloons, filled up, and then got into the arsenal, arming themselves with the United States guns and ammunition. They kept shooting at random and howling." The prisoners within the engine house heard a terrible firing from without at every point from which the windows could be seen, and in a few minutes every window was shattered, and hundreds of balls came through the doors. These shots were answered from within whenever the attacking party could be seen. This was kept up most of the day, and, strange to say, not a prisoner was hurt, though thousands of balls were embedded in the walls and holes shot in the doors almost large enough for a man to creep through. The doomed raiders saw volley upon volley discharged, while the echoes from the hills, the shrieks of the townspeople, and the groans of their wounded and dying, all of which filled the air, were truly frightful. Yet no powder and ball were wasted. We shot from under cover and took deadly aim. For an hour before the flag of truce was sent out, the firing was uninterrupted, and one and another of the enemy were constantly dropping to the earth. Oliver Brown was shot and died without a word, and Taylor was mortally wounded. The mayor of the city ventured out, unarmed, to reconnoiter and was killed. Immediately, the son of Andrew Hunter, who afterward was state's attorney against Brown, rushed into the hotel after the prisoner, William Thompson. We burst into the room where he was and found several around him, but they offered only a feeble resistance. We brought our guns down to his head repeatedly, myself and another person, for the purpose of shooting him in the room. There was a young lady there, the sister of Mr. Folk, the hotel keeper, who sat in this man's lap, covered his face with her arms, and shielded him with her person whenever we brought our guns to bear. She said to us, "For God's sake, wait, and let the law take its course." My associates shouted to kill him. "Let us shed his blood," were his words. All round were shouting, "Mr. Beckham's life was worth 10,000 of these vile abolitionists." I was cool about it and deliberate. My gun was pushed by someone who seized the barrel, and I then moved to the back part of the room, still with purpose unchanged, but with a view to divert attention from me, in order to get an opportunity, at some moment when the crowd would be less dense, to shoot him. After a moment's thought, it occurred to me that that was not the proper place to kill him. We then proposed to take him out and hang him. Some portion of our band then opened a way to him, and, first pushing Miss Folk aside, we slung him out of doors. I gave him a push, and many others did the same. We then shoved him along the platform and down to the trestle work of the bridge. He begged for his life all the time, very piteously at first. Thus he was shot to death as he crawled in the trestle work. The prisoners in the engine house now urged Brown to make terms with the citizens, representing that this was possible and that he and his men could escape. Brown sent his son Watson with a white flag, but the maddened citizens paid no attention to it and shot him down. A lull in the fighting came a little later, and Stevens took a second flag of truce, but was captured and held prisoner. Dangerfield says, "At night the firing ceased, for we were in total darkness, and nothing could be seen in the engine house. During the day and night I talked much with Brown. I found him as brave as a man could be, and sensible upon all subjects except slavery. He believed it was his duty to free the slaves, even if in doing so he lost his own life. During a sharp fight, one of Brown's sons was killed. He fell, then, trying to raise himself, he said, 'It is all over with me,' and died instantly. Brown did not leave his post at the porthole, but when the fighting was over, he walked to his son's body, straightened out his limbs, took off his trappings, and then, turning to me, said, 'This is the third son I have lost in this cause.' Another son had been shot in the morning, and was then dying, having been brought in from the street. Often, during the affair at the engine house, when his men would want to fire upon someone who might be seen passing, Brown would stop them, saying, 'Don't shoot. That man is unarmed.' The firing was kept up by our men all day and until late at night, and during this time several of his men were killed, but none of the prisoners were hurt, though in great danger. During the day and night many propositions, pro and con, were made, looking to Brown's surrender and the release of the prisoners, but without result. Another eyewitness says, 'A little before night Brown asked if any of his captives would volunteer to go out among the citizens and induce them to cease firing on the fort, as they were endangering the lives of their friends, the prisoners. He promised on his part that if there was no more firing on his men, there should be none by them on the besiegers. Mr. Israel Russell undertook the dangerous duty. The risk arose from the excited state of the people, who would be likely to fire on anything seen stirring around the prison house, and the citizens were persuaded to stop firing in consideration of the danger incurred of injuring the prisoners. It was now dark, and the wildest excitement existed in the town, especially among the friends of the killed, wounded, and prisoners of the citizens' party. It had rained some little all day, and the atmosphere was raw and cold. Now a cloudy and moonless sky hung like a pall over the scene of war, and, on the whole, a more dismal night cannot be imagined. Guards were stationed round the engine house to prevent Brown's escape, and, as forces were constantly arriving from Winchester, Frederick City, Baltimore, and other places to help the Harper's Ferry people, the town soon assumed quite a military appearance. The United States authorities in Washington had been notified in the meantime, and in the course of the night, Colonel Robert E. Lee, afterward the famous General Lee of the Southern Confederacy, arrived with a force of United States Marines to protect the interests of the government and kill or capture the invaders. Meantime, Cook had awakened to the fact that something was wrong. He left Tidd at the schoolhouse and started toward the ferry. Finding it surrounded, he fired one volley from a tree and fled. He found no one at the schoolhouse, but met Tidd, the whole farm guard, and one negro on the road beyond. They all turned and fled north, Tid and Cook quarreling. They wandered 14 days in rain and snow, and finally all escaped except Cook, who went into a town for food and was arrested. Robert E. Lee, with 100 Marines, arrived just before midnight on Monday, and one of the prisoners tells the story of the last stand. When Colonel Lee came with his government troops in the night, he at once sent a flag of truce by his aide, J.E.B. Stuart, to notify Brown of his arrival, and, in the name of the United States, to demand his surrender, advising him to throw himself on the clemency of the government. Brown declined to accept Colonel Lee's terms, and determined to await the attack. When Stuart was admitted and a light brought, he exclaimed, "Why, aren't you old Osawatomie Brown of Kansas, whom I once had there as my prisoner?" "Yes," was the answer, "but you did not keep me." This was the first intimation we had of Brown's real name. When Colonel Lee advised Brown to trust to the clemency of the government, Brown responded that he knew what that meant, a rope for his men and himself, adding, "I prefer to die just here." Stuart told him he would return at early morning for his final reply, and left him. When he had gone, Brown at once proceeded to barricade the doors, windows, etc., endeavoring to make the place as strong as possible. All this time, no one of Brown's men showed the slightest fear, but calmly awaited the attack, selecting the best situations to fire from, and arranging their guns and pistols so that a fresh one could be taken up as soon as one was discharged. When Lieutenant Stuart came in the morning for the final reply to the demand to surrender, I got up and went to Brown's side to hear his answer. Stuart asked, "Are you ready to surrender and trust to the mercy of the government?" Brown answered, "No, I prefer to die here." His manner did not betray the least alarm. Stuart stepped aside and made a signal for the attack, which was instantly begun with sledgehammers to break down the door. Finding it would not yield, the soldiers seized a long ladder for a battering ram and commenced beating the door with that, the party within firing incessantly. I had assisted in the barricading, fixing the fastenings so that I could remove them on the first effort to get in, but I was not at the door when the battering began and could not get to the fastenings till the ladder was used. I then quickly removed the fastenings, and, after two or three strokes of the ladder, the engine rolled partially back, making a small aperture, through which Lieutenant Green of the Marines forced his way, jumped on top of the engine, and stood a second amidst a shower of balls, looking for John Brown. When he saw Brown, he sprang about 12 feet at him, giving an underthrust of his sword, striking Brown about midway the body, and raising him completely from the ground. Brown fell forward with his head between his knees, while Green struck him several times over the head, and, as I then supposed, split his skull at every stroke. I was not 2 feet from Brown at that time. Of course, I got out of the building as soon as possible, and did not know till some time later that Brown was not killed. It seems that Green's sword, in making the thrust, struck Brown's belt and did not penetrate the body. The sword was bent double. The reason that Brown was not killed when struck on the head was that Green was holding his sword in the middle, striking with the hilt, and making only scalp wounds. After the attack on the troops at the bridge, Brown had ordered O.P. Anderson, Hazlitt, and Green back to the arsenal. But Green saw the desperate strait of Brown and chose, voluntarily, to go into the engine house and fight until the last. Anderson and Hazlitt, when they saw the door battered in, went to the back of the arsenal, climbed the wall, and fled along the railway that goes up the Shenandoah. Here in the cliffs they had a skirmish with the troops, but finally escaped in the night, crossed the town and the Potomac, and so got into Maryland and went to the farm. It was deserted and pillaged. Then they came back to the schoolhouse and found that empty. In the morning they heard firing, and Anderson's narrative continues. Hazlitt thought it must be Owen Brown and his men trying to force their way into the town, as they had been informed that a number of us had been taken prisoners, and we started down along the ridge to join them. When we got inside of the ferry, we saw the troops firing across the river to the Maryland side with considerable spirit. Looking closely, we saw, to our surprise, that they were firing upon a few of the colored men, who had been armed the day before by our men at the Kennedy Farm, and stationed down at the schoolhouse by C.P. Tidd. They were in the bushes on the edge of the mountains, dodging about, occasionally exposing themselves to the enemy. The troops crossed the bridge in pursuit of them, but they retreated in different directions. Being further in the mountains and more secure, we could see without personal harm befalling us. One of the colored men came toward where we were when we hailed him and inquired about the particulars. He said that one of his comrades had been shot and was lying on the side of the mountains, that they thought the men who had armed them the day before must be in the ferry. That opinion, we told him, was not correct. We asked him to join with us in hunting up the rest of the party, but he declined and went on his way. While we were in this part of the mountains, some of the troops went to the schoolhouse and took possession of it. On our return along up the ridge, from our position, screened by the bushes, we could see them as they invested it. Our last hope of shelter or of meeting our companions, now being destroyed, we concluded to make our escape north. Anderson managed to get away, but Hazlitt was captured in Pennsylvania and was returned to Virginia. Thus, John Brown's raid ended. Seven of the men, John Brown himself, Shields Green, Edwin Coppock, Stevens and Copeland, and eventually Cook and Hazlitt, were captured and hanged. Watson and Oliver Brown, the two Thompsons, Coggy, Jerry Anderson, Taylor, Newby, Leary, and John Anderson, 10 in all, were killed in the fight, and six others, Owen Brown, Tidd, Lehman, Barclay Coppock, Merriam, and O. Anderson, escaped. At high noon on Tuesday, October 18th, the raid was over. John Brown lay wounded and blood-stained on the floor, and the governor of Virginia bent over him. "Who are you?" he asked. "My name is John Brown. I have been well known as Old John Brown of Kansas. Two of my sons were killed here today, and I'm dying too. I came here to liberate slaves, and was to receive no reward. I have acted from a sense of duty, and am content to await my fate, but I think the crowd have treated me badly. I am an old man. Yesterday I could have killed whom I chose, but I had no desire to kill any person, and would not have killed a man had they not tried to kill me and my men. I could have sacked and burned the town, but did not. I have treated the persons whom I took as hostages kindly, and I appeal to them for the truth of what I say. If I had succeeded in running off slaves this time, I could have raised 20 times as many men as I have now for a similar expedition. But I have failed." End of section 17.